Greetings, humans, living and dying in the Anthropocene. This is Jamming Their Transmission, where rebels, freaks, critics, dissidents, iconoclasts, and oddballs live. I'm your fellow traveler, John Madero. In On Reading, Norman Locke posits, quote, "We read if for no other reason than to be more than we are, to go beyond ourselves, if only a short way, to know, if only in a small way, others, and finally ourselves. To read what we already know, therefore, is to confirm ourselves in our confinement, to draw the shade on the wider prospect, to narrow life deliberately as a river is narrowed by the channel that humbles it. To read only what is inscribed in the forms to which our reading has accustomed us is to remain at anchor on the verge of oceanic experience, tumultuous, dangerous, and thrilling, is to lose the chance to be enraptured or, an equally valuable emotion, terrified by life, as life is made manifest by art. Reading is our consolation for living only one life. Reading is another form of life, comparable in importance and largesse," unquote. And in his interview with Constantin Severin, Norman Locke states, quote, "My work, past and present, has been an attempt at the level of the sentence at myth-making, which is to push narrative art toward a condition of maximum meaningfulness, using a stylized and figurative language. I mean for it to be beautiful. Since having begun the American novels, I also intend that my fiction should have a moral and ethical point, albeit a subtle and tentative one. What I hope to accomplish in the American novels is to write stories that resemble myths without sacrificing historical authenticity and usefulness, to replace the lies and delusions that continue to influence our view of the political, societal, and environmental world," unquote. Norman Locke is the critically acclaimed author of novels, short fiction, and poetry, as well as stage, radio, and screenplays. His most recent books include the short story collection Love Among the Particles and 6 books in the American Novels series, including the recently published Feast Day of the Cannibals, about which Publishers Weekly wrote, quote, "This historically authentic novel raises potent questions about sexuality during an unsettling era in American history and is another impressive entry in Locke's dissection of America's past," unquote. Winner of numerous awards, Norman Locke lives in Aberdeen, New Jersey. Here's Norman Locke introducing and reading a passage from Feast Day of the Cannibals, published by Bellevue Literary Press, July 2019.
This is the 6th book in the American novel series, Feast Day of the Cannibals. It's set largely in New York City, in the Lower Manhattan section, around Wall Street, the Custom House, where many may not know of the sad end to Melville, but by the end of his life, the 1880s, 70s, and 80s, he was largely forgotten.
Yes.
His novels, even at Moby Dick, were out of print, and those who might have remembered him, as I've uncovered in my researches, thought of him as quite literally dead and were surprised to hear that he was alive still. He stopped writing fiction entirely after, I don't remember the bibliography now, but it was The Confidence Man. Mm-hmm. He wrote beyond Moby Dick without any critical success, then turned almost exclusively to the writing of poetry. And when the novel picks up in 1882, I think it is, in Lower Manhattan, Melville is working in the customs house, the customs service with the rank of inspector, or surveyor, taking inventory of ships, which was, I think, bitterly sweet and ironic for a man who, in the early part of his life, traveled all over the South Pacific and spent a year in the Spice Islands, but in the islands of the South Pacific, at one point jumped ship and spent some time in Hawaii, where he was a pin spotter, a pin setter in a bowling alley.
Oh, wow.
Here he is at the end of the last 20 years, forgotten, plunged into obscurity, without much money, working for the customs service. The novel is being told by a man, an unreliable narrator, as all of my narrators in the series are, a man named Shelby Ross, who had himself been a wealthy merchant in the city, with manufacturing interests that he inherited from his father, who made a fortune during the Civil War, as many did, and in the aftermath. But we like to think that our century, the 20th century, had the only Great Depression. But there were others in previous American centuries. 1837 was a depression. They called them panics in those days.
Hmm.
1873 was a severe financial panic that ruined some 20,000 businesses, if I recall, and resulted in a deep six-year recession. So the protagonist of the novel, Shelby Ross, has lost everything to that recession, and he too finds himself washed up in the custom house and in the service, in the employ of Melville.
Mm.
So that's the central relationship. There are two or three relationships. The central one, of course, is that between Shelby Ross and Melville. Shelby is telling his story to an acquaintance from his youth, Washington Roebling, who was the chief engineer on the Brooklyn Bridge. We enter the story with Ross congratulating Roebling on as the Brooklyn Bridge nears its finish.
Mm-hmm.
The readers of the book might have forgotten or not have been aware that Chief Engineer Roebling took over from his father, who was killed in a freak ferryboat accident on the river. And the father was the designer, the architect of the bridge. Washington Roebling, the son, was the engineer. And he caught the bends very early in the construction project. They didn't call it the bends then, but the decompression sickness that afflicted many of what they called the sand hogs, the Irishmen who were working, digging the foundations in the East River for the bridge. It took 14 years to build this bridge.
Mm.
And for most of those years, Roebling was an invalid who oversaw the project from Brooklyn Heights, second floor room in Brooklyn Heights, where you could see the bridge as it rose. So Ross is relating this story to Roebling as the bridge slowly rises in construction outside the window.
Hmm.
So what I'm going to read, this first excerpt, occurs about a third through the novel. It's set in Madison Square Park, April 15th, 1882, and I'll begin. We being Melville and Ross, we sat on an iron bench in the park. Melville seemed reluctant to go home. He's a taciturn man, embittered by ill fortune and Ross' fame. Yet you could almost say he enjoys his failure, as some people do the burning of a gum rub with salt. Night was drawing near, and the darkness had begun to sprawl. Edison's incandescent lamps had yet to light the city, which, until that time, would shelter what flourishes in the shadows. Edison, Westinghouse, Charles Brush, and you, Roebling, and your father before you, where does it come from, the inspiration, genius, gift, call it what you will, that gives into your hands the lever by which to move the world? Why you and not some others? And why should Melville fail and Samuel Clemens thrive? Why should Grant become a pauper when the war's great joke, George McClellan, became chief engineer of the New York City docks, and then the governor of New Jersey? And while I'm asking God to justify his nepotism, why am I a $3-a-day clerk, swallowed up by the cold or stifling holds of ships? I'm in the belly of a whale, and it intends to keep me there. My pain is nothing next to yours, Roland, but for God, there is nothing so salutary as the tears we shed for ourselves. They are the brine in which our aborted plants and failures are pickled. In the park, a night bird spoke to me in bird of the bitterness of winter snows. Thus is a happy moment buried under past regrets. Do you know what a gam is? Asked Melville. No. It's a kind of church social for whaling men when two ships chance upon each other. It relieves the boredom of a long sea voyage. Boredom is the worst of it. The sailor will sooner tolerate lice and fleas, hardtack and rancid poor cockroaches in the molasses, the slimy black wall, stench, and the heat of the forecastle. When men are shut up together for 3 or 4 years, their spirits can droop like their ship's own sails. When they're bored, men are at their most dangerous. He, Melville, grew thoughtful. And as I waited for him to continue, I opened a folded copy of the Tribune someone had left and let my eyes fall where they might. Do you believe in God? Asked Melville, prompted by some private musings. Thoughts lie penned up in a room, clamorous as cattle in a slaughterhouse, wanting to be let out. Although I was not sure I did believe in him, I replied, yes. But does he believe in you? I shrugged and, folding the paper, put it in my coat pocket. I waited for him to say more, but he had lapsed into the silence which was for him habitual. What made you miserable? I asked, barely concealing my impatience. At the time, I didn't know that his son Malcolm had shot himself in 1867, that Melville was considered another author whose mature work had failed to live up to its youthful promise, and that he had felt like a shipwrecked sailor in the land of Nod. I had mistaken a melancholy as profound as Edgar Poe's for sullenness. I regretted having agreed to dine with him. A greasy chop and a glass of porter would have been preferable to what now seemed like an inquisition by an inquisitor too weary or withdrawn to question me. I wished that I were elsewhere. Instead of feeling that I had gone to sleep and awakened inside a gloomy novel set on the English moors. Unseen within the leafing branches of a poplar tree, a squirrel began to chitter at the approach, no doubt of a predator with a taste for squirrel. Cannibalism is more common than the world supposes, I'd heard Melville mutter upon hearing that a stevedore on the Pearl Street Pier had killed a merchant seaman in a fight over a Negro woman and would shortly go to Sing Sing for it. What is cannibalism, if not spilling the blood to satisfy appetite? In the animal kingdom, one species serves as another's supper. According to Charles Darwin, it must be so. Am I being obvious? I'll tell you what I think, Roebling. The obvious is what in time becomes unseen, like a crack in the sidewalk on which one walks each day, or a mole in the cheek of someone kissed every morning and night. The obvious can also kill. Amid the leaves, the squirrel screeched a weird, unholy sound which abruptly ceased. It is a bleak house we live in, and sitting in the park while the first shadows began their sly encroachment on the daylit world, I shivered as if with cold.
This is Jamming Their Transmission, and you've been listening to Norman Locke reading from Feast Day of the Cannibals. So many things to talk about in this piece, Norman, including the questions within questions throughout. Would you talk about your use of the interrogative and interrogation, query and inquiry, and how this tendency manifests itself throughout your writing?
I think this can be traced, the questioning, which is incessant, can be traced back to my earliest work. It's certainly present even as far back in the 80s when I was writing plays. I've always felt, and I feel very strongly, even more so as the series progresses, that these narrators are actually surrogates for myself, and I suppose that's common enough. And perhaps why I employ them and have decided that they quite necessarily should be unreliable. They are myself. These pieces, these fictions are stages in which I enact my own puzzlement, my own ceaseless queries, which I'll be 69 next week. I still can't resolve these central questions, which we can talk about, which we can identify later. Mm-hmm. So the interrogatory is very much a part of these novels that feel their way along through the fabric of the story, trying desperately to understand what the characters and what myself encounter in life and during the writing of these stories, which raise issues of their own. Does that answer it?
Oh, yes, definitely. And your answer leads to further questions, which is the best kind of answer. Another prominent feature of this section is its intertextuality, its cross-referencing. There's a reference to Charles Darwin, yes, but there is Melville himself, a titanic text of a kind, speaking, and you are conjuring him through mimicry of his diction. Please talk about the play of texts here, the stories within stories, and the mimicry, the homage to various literary figures and styles.
My involvement with not historical fiction, because I wouldn't classify my writings as historical fictions or novels, but my involvement with history, and in the American series, obviously American history of the 19th century, and the literary history embedded in it is of long standing. I don't know where, I think it was by pure happenstance after writing the first of the novels, A Boy in His Winter, in which I blundered on and found myself mimicking Mark Twain. I don't know where that came from, that first impulse, but by the end of it, I recognized that there might be a way forward. And I've always been a writer who needed series and sequence and suites to operate within. See, it's easier for me to have an ongoing dialogue with, an intertextual dialogue, a dialogue with myself. And even if we're talking prose poems or collections of short stories, if there's an intertextual relationship, there's an inbuilt propulsion that carries me forward. I just find that very congenial. I think, and I wish I could remember that the professor that I had at Penn in my second or third year there, it was a course in American literature, and I remember her very well saying that there were really five or six important works of the 19th century and of the foundational books of our literature. I resisted, this is an irrelevancy at the moment, but I always resisted our literature as something, and my fellow American writers will have to forgive me, as something inferior to the work being produced in other languages, and we can talk about that later. Mm-hmm. But to come back to the observation of this professor long ago, she said that we have Walden, Leaves of Grass, the poetry of Emily Dickinson, the Scarlet Letter of Hawthorne, the essays of Emerson, Moby Dick, and some handful of short stories by Poe. They are our literatures, our national literature's foundational works. And I never forgot that. And I spent a good 35 years or longer writing in a European or South American, particularly an absurdist tradition, but I never forgot her observation about these works. Mm-hmm. And they became, I suppose, the prompts for the individual installments in the American novel series. And I've forgotten the question now. Where did this begin, John? Did I answer it?
Oh, you did, and it's great that we're getting lost here. And I also got lost in your lists here, your inventories, which resemble the sprawling lists in Melville's writing. Melville here offers a beautiful lyrical inventory. Quote, the lice and fleas, the hardtack and rancid pork, the cockroaches and the molasses, the slimy black walls, stench and heat of the forecastle, unquote, etc. Sounds like you're having fun here, cataloging and whatnot, as you're paying homage.
Oh, I do. I have a great deal of fun, more fun than frustration, as I write, and this has always been the case. And in the early works, and I know you are familiar with some of them,
mm-hmm.
before I turned to American literature, I wrote very much to satisfy a sense of play. I had a great deal of fun in writing the pieces of Love Among the Particles and pieces for small orchestra and the collection brought out by Fiction Collective to A History of the Imagination. This brings me, in fact, Erica wanted to know yesterday about my relationship to my previous work in regard to the idea of what might constitute experimental fiction. As you know, FC2 is exclusively, I suppose, a fine publisher of alternative and experimental fiction,
mm-hmm.
as is Spuyten. I never get the pronunciation wrong, not being from Brooklyn. Spuyten Divil. How do you pronounce that, John?
I pronounce it Spuyten Divil, but I might be wrong as well.
Divil. Okay. they published
Pieces of an Orchestra, right?
Collect. Yes, and a great deal of fun, and there was a lot of humor, and I think there's humor still in my work. But for me, what I was excited about early on, and when I say early on, I mean in the 70s, when I came of age in postmodernism, was the impulse toward iconoclasm, which might define experimental literature, the destruction of forms in order to create a new narrative or fiction, narrative structures or fictional strategies that will root out biases, mm-hmm. That will expand the circumference of fiction to reflect new ideas of consciousness. And I was very excited by that. And the more I did it, and I have been prolific, the more I worked through this vein and read the usual postmoderns, the more it seemed to become, at least in my case, a play with forms purely. The humanistic content, at least in my own work, I think it was there, but that wasn't my primary concern. My primary concern was creating on the page a space for play. Mm-hmm. There was also a place to confront and perhaps exercise my own anxiety, which can be intense. But after a time, after 35 years, and I'm only speaking about my own involvement with experimental texts, it no longer nourished. And playing with forms for its own sake no longer gave me the... it became restrictive.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is why I came back to the place that I started, which was American fiction, especially American fiction from the in the 19th century through the 30s.
Mm-hmm.
My first involvement as a reader when I was 14, 15 years old, I fell in love with the reading of novels. I can't recall his name, but he was, at the time, he wrote a number of historical novels set in American frontier, 19th century, Revolutionary War. And my mother would read them, and she would pass them on to me, and then I would read them. And I remember, I guess I was 15, and a minor epiphany. I said, I want to do this someday. And I find myself now in my late 60s doing that in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Not exactly. So that's why I've come back to this territory that I used to sit on. I used to sit on the beach, and this was before smartphones and the devices, and people would actually be sitting and reading on the beach. Everybody would be. And magazines, novels, popular novels, cheap novels, they were reading. And I would walk the beach as a young man and feel a little snide about nobody on this beach, and perhaps nobody in the state of New Jersey is reading what I happen to be reading right now, which might have been Landolfi or Ionesco or Calvino or someone. And it was a little exclusive club that I belonged to. Mm-hmm. And I took a little bit of smug pride in that. But so it's onward now.
Another striking element in this piece is the fabulous moment of the nightbird speaking and the moment with the squirrel. Please talk about these moments of the fantastic that happen here and there.
Those fantastic moments for me are the, again to use the word, the epiphanies that happen in the writing that almost miraculously emerge and provide the greatest satisfaction for me as a writer and as a thinking person. Their surfacing is marvelous, and I'm not the first writer or artist to make note of it and to exclaim at the wonderment of it. It's, I think, the great gift that we have, especially poets have, is this idea of the metaphoric opening, enlargement of the world. It comes in an instant, and if we're lucky enough to remember it or have a pencil and paper at hand to record it. So they come mysteriously like that. I don't know why. I was trained, and I was a very inferior poet as a young man. That's what I started out to write. I studied poetry, the literature and its craft at Penn and at Syracuse, and have an MFA from Syracuse in writing poetry, writing of poetry. And I did that for 10 years, I suppose, and it was, as you might expect, derivative. I was delighting in language and possibilities, but I had nothing to say. But that poetic pleasure has never left me, and I do read poetry still. In fact, I completed the 10th of these novels, the 10th of the American series novels, last month. And I'm going to take a year off, since I'm so far ahead of publication schedules, and read nothing but poetry. And my other great love is 20th century American art, especially abstraction. I'm going to read biographies of the abstract expressionists and the literature of that. I'm going to retire in my reading, at least, from thinking about the novel. So the source of those metaphors, I don't know, but I think I used to believe, John, that metaphors in this symbolic language were, and this is what I was taught in grammar school, they were picturesque rhetorical devices to make the writing sparkle, to make the writing more interesting, and that's what I use them for. Without too much thought, they presented themselves, and I used them. But lately, and again, this is not a unique idea, and it's rife in Emerson. I've been reading a lot of Emerson. He's the subject and the narrator of the 10th novel. And the idea that language and metaphor are symbols, are emblems for the natural world, and can invoke the presence of what lies behind or beneath the natural world, what he calls the great laws of nature. That can be reached somehow through the instantaneous, to give it a 21st century word, portal, through this portal. And so two widely divorced states of being or consciousness or time and place can be joined in an instant in a trope. And I now believe in that. I now believe one of the fights that I've waged with myself over the years is the quite common one about determinism and fate and free will, materialism versus, I don't mean to say, but let's say paranormal. The strictures and the shackles of materialism and determinism weighed on me, and I fought them all through my writing life. But I, since reading Emerson and reading, I am reading now, by the way, I'll give a testimonial for a book by Jeffrey Cripple called The Flip, Epiphanies of Mind and the Future of Knowledge. And it's due from Bellevue Literary Press. Actually, I think it was just released last month in March. And in it, he takes the idea of the very despised idea of determinism and spiritualism, preternatural, paranormal worlds, and he begins the very hard task of their reformation. And it's nothing new. As I said, Emerson, since I've read the two of these authors back to back almost, the ideas are very much Emersonian. Emerson got them from the German Spinoza and the German philosophers of the 18th and 19th century, especially from the English David Hume. This idea that there is a world behind matter. Matter and material conceal something else. Now we're stuck, of course, with what do we call this something else? No one wants to call it God, and I don't want to call it God, and Emerson himself did not call it God, did not believe in the Christian God. He believed in, as the great student of the world's myths. Oh, boy.
Joseph Campbell,
that the religions, the religions and the religious mind and state are simply emblems, again, masks of some great principle, which Emerson and Joseph Campbell locate within the human breast, within consciousness, and also wanting, I guess, to have it both ways, and this is something that if you get rid of the old either-or binary prison, you can have either way. It's an interpenetration of the exterior world and the interior world, their mutual interdependence, their mutual influence on each other. So you can reform these old obsolete terms to give them a modern relevance, which Cripple affirms is so very critical in terms of establishing a third mode of thinking and philosophy to counter the materialism that's killing the planet and killing us. I've always argued with myself since I was a teenager, if I could determine whether our lives are fated or determined, or we have free will, I would have all the wisdom necessary to lead my life and later to write my books. Emerson's opinion is that all is fated, all is determined, and yet he finds within himself, within his own consciousness, a small place, a circle in which the exercise of free will is possible. And for me, and I just read that last month, for me that became a way out of the prison, for I can acknowledge that, yes, my actions, as the neuroscientists affirm, and as astrophysicists announce, my actions and those of the universe are predetermined, and yet I can, by virtue of something within my consciousness, judge. I can hold and insist on a moral standard. Very important to me. And I think you would see that reflected in all the novels of the series, this struggle with the idea of, and it's certainly here, and even in the passage I just read, certainly present in the present book, in these questions that I ask. Am I off the track? I probably am, terribly.
Oh, no, not at all. And one of the things that this narrator asks is he being obvious? And this character then says, well, the obvious can also kill. So these questions that may seem rudimentary are actually questions that we must return to over and over again.
Exactly, John, exactly. They're not settled. In the 10th novel, it occurs in Concord, mostly in Emerson's house over the course of a day and a half. And he's visited by a fugitive, an army sergeant, black army sergeant who in El Paso has killed another soldier who insulted him and struck him. And now the idea of the black fugitive making his way north is repeated as it had been during before the Civil War. And Emerson is forced all over again to make the decision to do something, to act, to take responsibility. So it was. It may have seemed, and I think it. I grew up thinking, yes, it was all settled. This question of race was settled with the Lincoln's Proclamation and the 14th Amendment. It's all over. Now we're on to something else to challenge our moral judgment. But no, it continues, and we see that all the time. It continues.
In the American novels, you often write from the perspective of the so-called other. Would you talk about why you often engage this mode, employ it, about its inherent challenges? What are the responsibilities of the writer in this regard?
That's been very much that question of appropriation, which is another form of usurpation and annexation, has been very much on my mind since I began this. And it was especially present to consciousness as I was writing the fourth novel, which had to do with which was narrated by a fugitive, an escaped black slave who comes to Concord and lives in Walden Woods. That was a fugitive in Walden Woods,
mm-hmm.
the name of that novel. And I wondered while I was writing it, and I speak to my sense of responsibility, awe, and trepidation in the afterward to the book. Do I have the right? And my answer to that is, I may not have the right, but I have perhaps the obligation, which would supersede any previous doubts. I have the obligation as a thinking man or person, as a what I hope to be, in the old-fashioned words, a moral one. I have the obligation to confront challenges, attacks on justice and the human being, wherever I happen to see them in a fictional terrain. I don't know where that came from, the idea to write that, but it did. And I considered a while whether I ought to take it up, and decided that I wanted to, and I should. This idea of the other, if we're to avoid, either by excess of caution or discretion or fear, the attempt, as imperfect as it's bound to be, to inhabit someone else, anyone else, if we consider that we have the ability to do it, to try it, and we feel the obligation to attempt it, I think we must do it.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, I'm an old white man. I don't want to write about old white men. I want to write about the people that I may not know.
Mm-hmm.
I want to, in the struggle of writing it and researching it, come to know them better.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a mistake for anyone, as long as their intentions are honorable, as long as it's not simply to annex another's experience and to profit financially by it. Mm-hmm. We need to explore the other. Mm-hmm. I think one of the reasons I'm very comfortable to write about the 19th century is I don't know who my fellow Americans, my sister Americans are. I don't know if you know, John, and you, mm-hmm. your sense of modernity and contemporary scene, literature, and the arts is great. Mine is very, very small. Mm-hmm. I don't mix. There's no one here to talk to in New Jersey. I see very few people. I see no one whose conversation is inclined to anything other than sports and cars, fishing I like or did. But I don't know what people are throughout. I don't know my 300 million or so fellow citizens. And I think it behooves me to try to know them. And I feel comfortable and safe on a safer ground if I imagine them in the guise of their distant ancestors. Mm-hmm.
Please talk about the reading you do for these novels, the research you do, and then talk about how you synthesize the research in order to produce vital embodied fiction. How do you keep these novels from sounding researched? From sounding like a stodgy academic treatise?
That's a good question. I get an idea that seems to be viable. A basic, I want to write, the book I'm thinking about writing next, which would be the 11th in the series, is Winslow Homer, the American illustrator and artist who really, it reminds me of Beckett in that he withdrew. Beckett was always withdrawn, but Winslow Homer was very famous, and as artists go, rich, lived in New York, and he was an illustrator in a time when things were illustrated rather than accompanied by photographs, and he was accomplished. But he is thought of at present, that the majority of his work as an accomplished illustrator and not a true artist like contemporary Thomas Eakins. But for whatever reason, and I haven't researched it deeply enough to know why, he abandoned New York, he abandoned illustration, he abandoned the world just as truly as Beckett did, and went to a Prout's Point in Maine near, I guess it's almost up to Canada, very desolate, and he lived almost monastically, saw a few people, conversed little, and just concentrated on looking at the sea, which is very cold and rough up there, obviously, with the sea and the sky. And his early pictures were included human figures, the lone fisherman or the fishing smack, the beachcomber, the lone coast guardsman. But eventually he purged his canvases of all traces of the human, and we get these monumental seascapes and cloudscapes. That to me is a tremendous idea for a fiction about an artist, especially one who is looking back, as I will be doing more and more, on his past. Now, how I would go about the writing of that once I have the idea, which I have, is I will do what I did in all of these novels. I won't research it heavily because I don't want to be encumbered by a pile of 3x5 cards. And what I'll do, in fact, with a Thoreau novel, I found a young person's biography, young reader's biography of Thoreau, which gave me the outline of his story. And in that, I found a spine. And then I consulted, and I could not have written any of these books if it weren't for the internet. It would be impossible because of the research, because of where I'm located. Mm-hmm. Without a library, without any kind of without a major library. So I do then, I fill out in my mind, and I'll take notes of Wikipedia entries, those that are reliable on the subject. And I'll usually find there, and if you follow the links, the hypertextual links, you'll find anecdotes from their lives, and you'll find enough to get going with. And once I have a first draft that I'm comfortable with, and I'll work over a couple of times rewriting, I'll have a skeleton, well, more than a skeleton, but then I do the heavy research, not as a scholar would in writing treatise or thesis, but I find those books that are recommended by those who know the field, and I'll get biographies and literary historical analyses of my figures, and I'll read through those, and I'll do two things. I'll correct the mistakes that are in the early drafts, then I'll flesh out what's there. Mm-hmm. And by then, I'm usually the third or the fourth draft. Then I put the research aside, and I'll usually put the work aside for some months, then come back to it, and then begin to approach it as a text, improving and refining and excising it. And that is where often the metaphors will, for some reason, will come. Mm-hmm. And they'll flower within the lines. So that's my basic method, John. Start with something simple. I think, if I don't know if you remember, they might not have them any. There were published when I was a kid, there were what they called classic comics. They were thicker than your Superman comics. They were devoted to the retelling of, they had one for Moby Dick, retelling of the classics. And I'm sure that there would, you would be able to begin with writing of a serious novel with one of those as a preliminary spine to something. It doesn't take much to begin with. And as I say, the danger, at least for me, would be to go into the writing, to begin the writing with too much scholarly information. I would be bogged down.
This is Jamming Their Transmission. I'm John Madera. I've been speaking with Norman Locke about Feast Day of the Cannibals, the latest novel in the American Novels series. Here's Norman Locke introducing and reading from another passage from Feast Day of the Cannibals.
As I said at the outset, when I was setting the scene for the book, it's being narrated by the unreliable narrator who works for Melville in the customs service, Shelby Ross. He's telling his story to Washington Roebling from Roebling's second story room on Brooklyn Heights. And the date is now May 17th. 1884. Melville, and this is Shelby Ross speaking. Melville, he goes on as always. He's the rock on which he dashes himself to pieces. In my cell, I read his adventure stories, Typee, Umo, White Jacket, and Moby Dick. I'll read them again on lonely, damp winter nights with the coal stove roaring like Ahab's own ocean of curses. I'm no Ahab, Roebling, except in the immensity of the hatred I conceived for John Gibbs. It had been simmering for months, but the boiling over seems to have taken hardly any time at all. 3 weeks, four. When it did rise up in me, it was scalding. Ahab. A man with such a name could never be a cringer, a worrier after his virtue and his purse, a petitioner whose whimper has turned hoarse in supplication, whose trouser knees are worn, whose head is bowed and back is bent, whose element is a slurry of cinders, wet ash, and horses stale, staining the winter snow through which he tramps resignedly from almshouse to poorhouse until he is carried to his last and smallest house, a plain coffin in a pauper's grave. Not that I'm any of those things, mind you. I never once begged the judge for mercy, but my fury did not last, and like a pot taken off the boil, the hatred subsided when the cause was removed. What a name is Ahab. To be called thus must sever a boy from dependency, put iron in his marrow, and make a cold forge of the heart. It is a name to blow him out of childhood and into the fullness of life, never mind the cost. Only a man of uncommon strength of will can bear the name of the seventh king of Israel, and the ruler of Moab, whose corpse was defiled by dogs and swine, according to the prophecy of Isaiah, and whom God hated. I shouldn't mind being hated by him, if I could be in the company of such a man, even if he was laid waste in Gilead and buried in a sty. King Ahab roared his defiance as I would wish to do mine when the time comes. Melville's famous captain did the same, although I'd sooner have been in the retinue of the Israelite than aboard the Pequod with its crazed master and crew. Ahab, raised in the Holy Land or in Nantucket, was accursed by God. Sometimes I think I am as well, although my Christian name would suit an effete poet or a parlor snake. They all come at last to our story's end, and I don't give a damn if my husk, after the great winnowing, molders in the ground on Ward's Island, or in my father's crypt of Greenwood Cemetery, a pleasure park for cast-off flesh soon to be no more. Our bones are none the worse for common dirt, so long as they danced when the body was quick. That was the philosophy of my father, who began life a poor boy and ended in the handsome tomb of a merchant prince. Having been rich for a time, he'd had the foresight to buy a vault in which he and his heirs could dwell in perpetuity, a condition existing nowhere except in the deed to a cemetery allotment. In prison, I had 2 years to ponder, the wheel of fortunes having turned against me. In my fancy, I chose to think of them as a sojourn on one of the Heliades, the seven islands in the ocean stream where the vines pair and the apple trees. Some good came of my classical education, after all. In my story, I owe my escape to Melville, who rowed me across the harbor to a waiting ship, just as the grown Pip had done for Magwitch. He was taken and drowned, but in my daydreams I fared better. I embarked on the Highlander, captained by a saintly man, which carried me, as in a dream, to the ocean between India and Ethiopia called the Arabian Sea. I know why we tell one another stories. The reason is not, as Martin claimed, to console us for having only one life to call our own. Stories help us to endure it.
This is Jamming Their Transmission, and that was Norman Locke reading from Feast Day of the Cannibals. Norman, do your thoughts about stories correspond, concur with the narrator's here?
Yes.
The narrator's thoughts here struck me as being in conversation with Joan Didion's We Tell Ourselves Stories in Order to Live. But here you're saying it's not merely to live, but to endure.
To endure. Yes. What is a story is something that writers and readers alike spend a great deal of time, I think, pondering. What constitutes a story, I think, is the question that many alternative writers of fiction or of experimental texts are asking of themselves and of their readers. What are the basic requisites of a story? What can a story hope to accomplish? Who is the reader? What is the obligation of the writer to the reader? Those I used to enjoy, used to think important, but not so much anymore. Again, moving beyond, at least in my own thinking about stories, and certainly my own wish to write them, moving beyond mere formulaic experiments and attitudes toward humanism. Stories, unlike what I thought of as a story coming up as within postmodernism, a story is not or need not be considered as independent from real life, as a representation of reality only. A story can, in the oldest image of all, can mirror, hold the mirror up, and can reflect, and can, and I think the sacred purpose of a story is, to come back to your earlier line of question, is to help us understand the other. Writers spend a lot of time using fiction, using painting, using the arts to understand themselves and to grapple with issues of their own metaphysical or psychological, and I continue to do that, as I said. But I'm equally now interested, passionately interested, in what the story, a story can, or a play, a painting can tell me about this other person that I share the universe with, whom I have no other way of knowing, and can come to an understanding of, admittedly, only imperfectly through the arts. So yes, stories are important in a way that I had not considered earlier in my life, and endure as we come, as unfortunately most of us come to find living very difficult in our own circumstances, painful, a story can help us endure it, not only by the obvious way of misery loves company, I don't mean that, but there's an element of that too, but we need to, again, if we can share in the pain of the race of men and women, if we can share in that, have some understanding in that, it puts our own in perspective, and we realize that we're not simple beings in paradise who owe it to ourselves to be happy and to be well. We're not going to be always. That helps us. Stories will help us endure.
One of the dynamic ways or means you're articulating or conveying this story, these stories, is through the sentence, through a particular use of the sentence. As in all of your books, there is, in this book, great attentiveness to musicality, to the sonorities of the sentence. Here, the sentences resemble Melville's, and like Melville's, are also influenced by the King James Bible and classical texts. Please talk about your approach to sentence-making, to the music of sentences.
The sentence has always been, for me, the essential aspect of writing and this, the essential joy that I take from it, writing a beautiful sentence. And I want to ask you a question at the end of my response, John, that will remind me, what do you think of beauty in terms of the sentence and art? But for me, writing a beautiful sentence is a joy. Mm. And a beautiful sentence is musical, as you said, is rhythmic. And I, too, was influenced by, as a young person, by what I read and what I heard in church. As a boy, the King James Bible and the other works of great literature, including Moby Dick, which I read as a young person. That kind of sound in that kind of literature, which can seem almost obsolete perhaps today, a jagged musicality. I grew up with that in my ears, and that's what resonates for me. And grammar is essential. I learned the importance of grammar and came to consider grammar itself as beautiful. And I would no more think of defying the laws of the grammar than I would of gravity, if it were possible. grammar keeps the center won't hold without grammar for me. Syntax is the web in which our most elusive thoughts can be caught. There's no excuse in my mind for shoddy grammar. It does the work a disservice, and it limits what we can say, and it certainly limits the writer's, the reader's understanding of what is being said. It's painful for me to end my own obsessive compulsive nature speaking. I can't even today end a written sentence with a preposition. I learned that in seventh grade, and I cling to it. So I'm very, I suppose, conventional in that sense. But those rhythms, the great thunderous rhythms of the Bible and of Whitman.
Whitman, yes.
I've always read Whitman, and read him now. I keep going back to Whitman. And those great, what they call pictorial periods, those rhythms, phrases, that for me, and the poetry that I was reading, the poets that I was reading, and whose work was published in the 50s, the 40s, 50s, and 60s, that for me is what language is. And I realize it isn't what language is today. So what do you think? Is there a place for beauty in language, or does it make a book like mine or a style like mine suspect to a number of people who would consider it old-fashioned and irrelevant?
Thanks, Norman. That was a beautiful response. As for my view, the audience for language that isn't strictly utilitarian or so-called transparent, a misnomer if there ever was one, has diminished, has dwindled, and is continually dwindling. And one of the forces that compel this right now is the machines, the ubiquity of them, the machines taking prominence and dominating what you might call everyday life. Language decays as certain technologies overpower a certain kind of consciousness. Attention as a whole deteriorates. Authentic desire diminishes. You know, people on average look at paintings in a museum for about 27 seconds. 27 seconds! You can't possibly see, absorb all a work of art has to offer in such a duration. You can spend all day looking at a Rothko, or a Basquiat, or a Helen Frankenthaler, or Elaine de Kooning, and still not receive everything it has to communicate. And yet people think they've seen something they actually haven't seen. And they've even taken a photo of themselves next to it, in front of it, because they haven't immersed themselves in it, because the quality of their attention, their awareness, their vocabulary, their desire is thoroughly diminished. As the society continues to devolve, not only politically but culturally, linguistically, etc., as it privileges the easily absorbed image over the complex image, the simple text over the difficult lexical text, we're going to see the audience for anything that requires nuanced perspective, prolonged attention, willingness to be challenged, perplexed, etc., continually diminished. That said, this is a call to all of us artists to continue making. This goes back to your notion of obligation. The artist is obligated to make these objects. The fur-covered cup that breaks your heart. The objects that slow down perception. That not only makes things new, but makes things strange. That extend and prolong perception and analysis, to make the strange beautiful and the beautiful and quotidian and whatever else utterly strange.
I agree, John. I agree. It's the old Beckett lament, which I can't quote, that ends with the obligation to create. You probably remember that. There's nothing to say, nothing with which to say it. He goes a few more periods and then in the obligation to say it. So regardless of how increasingly difficult and formidable the obstructions are to the pursuit of any art, there's still this, first is the joy in doing it, but then there's the larger, if one wishes to reach an audience for any purpose other than vanity, there's the obligation. And that's, for me, the distinction between the important arts, the important examples of the arts, and those that end up being considered as inconsequential. Is it important? Does one have the compulsion to say it, coupled with the obligation to say it, that obligation being one that's humanistic?
Mm-hmm.
That's where I've come to be in terms of my own pursuit of it.
Another thing that prevents people from experiencing art in all of its fullness, that keeps them from seeking it out as a regular part of their daily practice or whatever, is that art, all significant art, ultimately points to our mortality. And few people want to come face to face with death. Better to engorge superhero flicks and other capitalist claptrap than engage art that points to that grand and awful and terrible inevitability.
Yes. So, mortality, yes, that's obviously one of, not only my theme, that's one of the great themes of literature, certainly. For me, there are three questions. How are we to be in the world? How are we to act in the world? And how are we to, how are we to die from the world? And when I say from the world, I don't know whether existence goes on in some other form. Last year I would have said no. This year I'm open to some survival of consciousness or energy. I certainly don't believe in Elysian fields or Christian paradise or any faith's paradise, but it is hard, and I suppose that's the conservatism of that comes with old age, except to everyone except the real skeptics. We want to think that something is, we want to leave our books behind, and we want something of our atoms to go forward. That's the weakness of humanity, the weakness of our human and frail natures.
Would you read another piece for us?
I will.
Great.
This is a scene at McSorley's Ale House at 15 East 7th Street, East Side. April 30th is the time, 1882. Through Melville, Shelby Ross has come to meet Grant, ex-president Grant, who is living in the city and dying in the city. As we know, he died of throat cancer. This is at the beginning of his last illness before the cancer was diagnosed. Grant had lost everything in the panic. His son had taken a partnership in an investment firm, and the partner had absconded with the money. Anyway, Grant lost everything. He was pretty much penniless at the end of his life. And his great friend, Sam Clemens, Mark Twain, took it upon himself to do something for the former president and general by publishing his memoirs, which, by the way, were published and are considered still to be the greatest single collection of memoirs in American history, especially as it concerns the Civil War. So Shelby Ross comes to visit Grant at Grant's house and finds Mark Twain there. And this is the scene immediately after when Clemens has invited Shelby to go to McSorley's to have a drink. Clemens wanted to have a drink among the Irish so that he could count his lucky stars. He'd had the good sense to be born with Scotch running through his veins. Mostly, my ancestors were Cornish, who drank whatever they could smuggle or was washed up on the beach from a ship they'd wrecked, he said after wiping beer foam from his shaggy mustache. Terrible lot of sinners come from Cornwall. You were hard on the general, I said brusquely. I felt a grievance coming out like a rash during the elevated ride to the Lower East Side. You mustn't mind what I said. God and Grant know what I think of him. The poor man has always had a hard scrabble life. He was a fine president. He outlawed the Klan, came down on the carpetbaggers, and pushed the 15th Amendment through a Congress of jackasses. He fought for freedmen's rights at a time when one half of the population wanted to lynch the other. And contrary to public opinion, which comes as near the truth about as often as Halley's Comet does Earth, he was not a drunkard. The soldiers loved him, and soldiers won't follow a drunkard into the valley of the shadow of death, leastways not when they're sober. Clemens picked at a tooth with his fingernail and said, my mouth tastes of smoke and cinders. I'm not sure God meant us to ride in trains two stories above the street, although the view was breathtaking. I could count the number of Chinese cigar rollers and Hebrew rag pickers that can fit in a tiny tenement house room. He downed his beer as if to flush the modern world from his system, including James Page's diabolical typesetter, which was ruining him. He banged his empty schooner on the bar and called for another. How is life in the custom house? Not much of one, I replied. I'm moving to San Francisco. Frisco will be the making of you. Broad, wholesome, and charitable views of human beings cannot be acquired by vegetating in a corner all one's life, he declared, fixing an eye on proceedings behind the bar. The landlord, an oily man whose nearly identical height and girth made him tend toward the spherical, had just sliced the foam from a glass, from a beer glass with a paddle, and was setting it proudly before Clemens as if he'd cut the Koh i Noor diamond. Having embarked on a third whiskey, I was beginning to grow fond of the curmudgeon, whose obstreperous hair looked like the snakes of Medusa. I'm worried about that throat of his, said Clemens, showing genuine concern for his friend. Too many cigars, I said. The trouble with Grant is his heart. You wouldn't know it to look at him, Shelby, but he's a sweet old crust. I've known him to be downright sentimental when he's drunk, though he is not a drunkard. Not every man who drinks is a sot any more than every man who fiddles is Nero or one of them Strasbourgs. Clemens dipped a finger in his beer and, revolving it on the rim of his glass, produced a note weird and sostenuto, which was once thought to drive women mad. It reminded me of the sound of a fingernail on slate or a tune played on a saw. A dog lying on the sawdust floor began to whine pitiably. That'll be enough of that, gent, or I'll stick that glass where you'll never see it again, growled a big burly fellow with pig's bristles on his chin, a Stephen or a Carter by the look of him. I'm sorry you have no ear for music, sir. Infuriated, the man leaned across me and grabbed Clemens by the lapel of his white suit. Clemens called to the landlord, who was gathering up bottles in his beefy arms as if they were his children. Mr. McSorley, I presume. The name's Hannigan, said the man with the bottles. Mr. Shenanigans, is this not the Amateur Musical Society? And haven't I been invited to entertain with my glass harmonica? It is not, and you have not, replied an indignant Hannigan. It seems then that I have made a mistake, not the first, nor in all likelihood the last. My apologies, and God's blessing on you all. Good sir, if you will let go of my lapel, I'll stand you to a drink of Jameson or the noble Bushmills. I would also like a dish of ale drawn for the dog whose ears I unwittingly offended. The man let go. Clemens smoothed the rumpled fabric of his coat. A great pity that I left my ancient order of Hibernians pin on the other coat. It would have prevented this misunderstanding between friends, not forgetting man's best friend whose slumbers I disturbed. The Irishman thought it better to accept the whiskey and remove himself to the other end of the bar rather than prolong a discussion with a lunatic. One for me and for my friend, said the imperturbable comedian to the landlord, who by now had returned the bottles to the shelf above which lolled a painted lady dressed in feathers. Rolling, I couldn't decide whether I ought to be afraid or amused.
This is Jamming Their Transmission. I'm John Madera. You've been listening to Norman Locke reading from his latest novel, Feast Day of the Cannibals. Did you actually go to McSorley's and to the Brooklyn Bridge and Greenwood Cemetery, Ward's Island, as you wrote this? Or...
No. No. as you probably know, Erica Goldman and her Bellevue Literary Press have moved from the purlieus of Bellevue Hospital. They're now down toward the Battery. And visiting there yesterday and walking some of the streets from the Oculus to their office building, I saw some of these names. I noticed the names of these streets in which my Melville has walked for the first time. It was my first time in that part of New York. If it weren't for research and if it weren't for Google Maps and maps, I depend a great deal on terrain maps, satellite imagery, Google Maps, and maps published online that were drawn at the time of in which my novels were set. So, no, I haven't been there. In fact, I haven't been to Concord, haven't been to I haven't been much of any place. I don't think I've been to New England at all. And outside of New York and the theater district, not much there either. There's a line in the narrator speaks in the first novel, The Boy in His Winter, where he says, I have been a tourist on the internet. And that's very true of me.
How did it feel to be walking those self-same streets that Melville walked after having researched and finished the book?
It gave me a wonderful feeling in that the book is going to be released in July, and there I was. It was not the best of days yesterday, and that was cold.
Yeah.
And damp. I was surprised. I was surprised by the bustle, and I was surprised by the thick crowds. I don't think I'd expected that. Yeah, I thought that the financial district would be fairly desolate. That's a very naive thought, but I was surprised by the crowds. But I was delighted to be there, and when it is warmer, I'm going to go back and I'm going to retrace. There is a published online a walking tour of Melville, which I intend to take.
Why is the book called Feast Day of the Cannibals?
That's a question that I don't know if I can answer. Obviously, cannibals and cannibalism are central to the book, as they are to cannibalism is a theme throughout Melville, and cannibalism certainly defines a menacing aspect and the animus that works throughout the novel. So cannibal was a word that was suggested to me by reading Melville King early on. I don't know where the feast day came from. It probably came at the same place that metaphors come from, in symbolic language, but I guess the subconscious.
It's also darkly comedic, while also having religious overtones.
Yes. Good. Thank you.
That's what you could say to the next interviewer. Is there an envisioned end to the America series?
I keep saying that there is, and I keep saying one, and then I keep saying one more. In terms of the initial project, the tent, which is not yet the inward fire quenched, about Emerson, as I said, that's the tenth, and that's finished. And that I envisioned several novels back would conclude it. That does conclude the strategy of telling 19th century history, which is, again, foundational and ever-present. The themes are ever-present now in the culture. That does conclude the lens through which those books are told, which is through the most prominent writers of that time, which have come down to us. There are no other, well, certainly the many, many writers, but in terms of that initial list that was suggested by Pete, the teacher at Penn, and in terms of my own experience of the 19th century American literature, that they are the important books and writers, and it will come to an end, but there will be others. As I said, the 11th book will take up an American artist in the final years of the 19th century.
Why are you troubled by the term historical fiction when it comes to describing your own work?
Maybe I misunderstand it. I know there's the historical, I think it's called the Historical Fiction Magazine or Historical Fiction Review, that sometimes will praise some of the novels and did not like the last one, which was Emily Dickinson, Wreckage of Eden, thinking that it did not. They enjoyed the story. The reviewer enjoyed the consummate way in which I brought the time to life, but took exception. Finally, in the last critical line of the review, took exception with my inability, they took it as a negative, my inability to find a resolution. And of course, it is precisely the resolution that is sought throughout many of these books, and which finally eludes the the narrator. But I think the kind of his traditional, the conventional work of historical fiction seems to me, and it may be my misunderstanding of the genre, but it seems to me more the costume drama, the elements of that seems to me an appropriation. The elements of a time, a character, are taken and told either in the sense of appropriating and making a story. There is a great appetite for historical fiction. And in the cases of those historical fictions that I might admire, the sense that it's a straight, almost an historical or a scholarly, not a scholarly, but it's a straight and honest treatment of the character, of the historical, the factual character. Whereas mine, I do strive in all of these to be true to the history mm-hmm. and true to the personalities and the characters. But I do also use these in a way I think an historical novelist wouldn't, to air my own doubts, my own, this idea of the inquiries that you spoke of earlier. I use these just to resolve and to work toward resolutions of my own thoughts. So I'm, in guise of the narrator, I'm constantly inserting myself, although invisibly, I hope, into the story. I don't think that would qualify as a conventional historical fiction.
So there's an element of autofiction,
yes,
however submerged.
Yes, yes.
Before I let you go, Norman, I have a couple general questions for you. It's wonderful to hear you read from your work, Norman. I wonder if you read aloud during the revision process.
I'm reading, I'm vocalizing, but mutely, if you know what I mean. Uh-huh. The jaw, everything's working, and I always have a sore throat after doing it, so and aching muscles in the jaw. I don't read aloud because I don't want to annoy my wife, but I do vocalize mutely, so I hear everything.
Have you ever taught writing?
Yes, I taught it for 10 years, but I taught it in an unusual circumstance. I taught it in a federal prison.
Oh, wow.
A state prison and then a federal prison at night. And it was classes toward their earning an associate's degree from the community college that was located in the same area.
Would you ever return to teaching?
I enjoyed it for a long time, and then I didn't. I was also working during the day full time, so it was difficult and exhausting. I don't see myself returning to it anymore. I relish the time that I have now, I have no obligations. I'm not one to eschew an obligation, but I leave my obligations to my art now, and I don't want to take the time anymore to teach as an adjunct. I did that as well.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
I did teach the personal essay, but I also designed a program and got the prison administration's approval to do an actual creative writing program in which I devised an extensive series of writing exercises that taught, I think very creatively, that taught how to approach language in a creative manner. For example, I taught, I would teach the idea of point of view I would pose them a number of questions, such as imagine yourself. Imagine that you are being seen through the viewfinder of a high-powered rifle, and imagine the point of view, or imagine you are the bullet traveling toward a target. Those kinds of stretches of the imagination, which they took to, if you got what I was trying to get at. I don't have them anymore. I passed them on to someone.
I would love to see that, but there were a series of prompts, essentially.
Yes. Well, I had enough to teach for an entire year, and then I would recycle, do it again.
Yeah. You've been published by Gordon Lish a number of times, and I wonder if you might talk about your relationship with him, your interactions with him.
Yes, he published, I sent to the Quarterly in the 90s. I sent a piece, a short story to the Quarterly. I sent several, and he sent one back, and he was his want. He had removed, he had excised all but a paragraph, a couple of paragraphs from it, and he said, if you're willing to publish it as I've edited, I'll take it. After thinking about it, I saw what he had done, and I admired it very much, and it opened up a new, he actually reduced a short story to a prose poem, I think, mm-hmm. is what he'd done. Mm-hmm. It made it better. Mm-hmm. It made it something else, but it made it better. Mm-hmm. And I agreed, and couple of years that followed, I was working then on the stories of the history of the imagination, and I would send them to him, and he took all that I sent him, and he edited them, and I think he took eight or so pieces, and unfortunately, the Quarterly closed before any of them were published, but we continued to correspond, and he called me one night at home and invited me to attend his class. And I told him I had no money for that. And he called me the next day and he said he'd pay for it. It would be free.
Wow.
And I had to tell him that even still, I lived in South Jersey, which was quite a distance from New York. And I was teaching, working all day and teaching all night. And I just couldn't do it.
Yeah.
And he understood. And from then on, we corresponded for 10 years.
Oh, wow.
Every week I would send him a letter or two, outrageous, nothing serious, just comical whimsies, extravaganzas, comedies, which he enjoyed very much. And he would return in kind, but always in his hard to read at first, and on the back of a postcard. And I have 800 of those postcards. I'm very proud of them.
Oh, wow.
And I found him a wonderful, wonderful man. I know I read sometimes, or I read sometimes, that the people, students, had trouble with his classes. And there were those who admired him and those who didn't. But I admired him immensely, and then it was very, very fond of him, and am still. I owe him a lot. In fact, I think the language that evolved during the writing of the pieces for Love Among the Particles, which were written in a 10-year space before they were published as a book by Erica in 2013, that came from Gordon, not from his own published work, which had no influence on me, but from his letters and his postcards. They were, in their language, they were as unlike his work as you can imagine. They were all very, the prose is very elegant, very formal, very Edwardian. And that had an influence on me and also gave me, I guess, psychic permission to write in that way, which is the way that I would prefer to write.
Well, thank you so much, Norman, for speaking with me today. I really appreciate it.
I appreciate it too, John. I learn a lot about myself and my own preoccupations and methods when I do go through these exercises. We've only met once, but you've been a friend, friend of the work, and a champion. And
in fact, this all began with you. If you remember how you were taken with an early book of, not an early book, but a book of mine, recommended it to Toby, who recommended it to Erica, who solicited something from me, which turned out to be Love Among the Particles. So in that chain of events, you were the prime mover, which I've never forgotten.
And I thank you.
Oh, it's beyond my pleasure, Norman. Thanks so much for you, for your writing, for being on Jamming Their Transmission. I'll speak with you soon. That does it for our show. Thanks for listening to Jamming Their Transmission. I'm John Madera. Until next time, and always, be the strange you wish to see in the world.